It is minus 38 degrees in here. I have never been anywhere this cold. I've had to insulate my camera so the batteries keep working and keep a microphone close to my body so the wiring doesn't freeze and fall apart. This is the United States National Ice Core Laboratory in Denver, Colorado. And I figured it was best to interview the scientists that work here outside this giant freezer.
We have about 20,000 meters worth of ice represented here. And that's from probably anywhere from 60 to 80 different boreholes around the world. The deepest one we have is about 3,600 meters through the ice sheet of Antarctica. In our lab, the oldest ice that we have is about 420,000 years old, and that's from the Vostok ice core drilled in East Antarctica back in the mid-90s.
When a new core comes in, we piece it up and ship it out to principal investigators. All of this is meteoric ice, which means ice that's fallen from the sky. They don't want any of the tundra or sea ice because it would contaminate the meteoric ice that we'd have. One of the principal investigators who was running an analysis can check his system from home, and he asked if somebody was eating potato chips in the break room because he started seeing a higher amount of sodium in his samples. And they said, well, yeah. That's how sensitive this is. If the mains fail, we have a natural gas fuel generator out and back. It automatically switches power to the freezer building. We're 100% backed up on everything.
Each one of these tubes contains a sample of ice from the Arctic or Antarctic, and the deeper underground the core was taken from, the older it is. All that fallen snow crushed down over perhaps hundreds of thousands of years, along with anything else that happened to be dragged along from the atmosphere.
Pretty much anything that's in the atmosphere, whether it's the atmospheric gases or dust or anything like that, eventually lands on the ice sheets of Antarctica and Greenland and will get buried and trapped within the snow. And as that compresses into ice, it preserves that information. So we can actually use these ice cores to recreate what our atmospheric chemistry was like, dating back to about 850,000 years ago. We can also determine what global temperatures were and how they changed over time by studying the stable isotopes of oxygen within the water molecules. Essentially, they're looking at the ratio between 0.016 and 0.018, and by using a lot of modern-day studies, they can figure out what the temperature was in the area where that snow fell. There's a wide variety of ways that we can date these ice cores. With Greenland cores, oftentimes we can actually see visible layers that change from summer to winter based on the dust concentration. So, sort of like tree rings, count those seasons going backwards and get a date that way. And then occasionally we'll run across things like volcanic ash layers. And if there's enough material within an ash layer, we can use radiometric dating to get a very specific age on that volcanic layer. The margin of error in terms of our ages are usually within, you know, plus or minus 10 years or so. So it's pretty accurate, especially when we're looking at ice that's a few hundred thousand years old. By understanding the natural variations of climate change, we can better predict what's going to happen moving forward now that humanity has made a pretty significant impact on what's going on with our planet in terms of the amount of greenhouse gases that we put into the atmosphere over the last century. We can better understand the past, and using that knowledge of the past, we can better model what's going to happen moving forward into the future.
Thank you to all the team here at the US National Ice Core Laboratory. Pull down the description for more about them and about their work. And I think my eyelids are sticking together.
Yeah, you can't see it, but you do have frost all on your eyelashes.
Really?
Right now. Yeah.